back in the church. When I went home today, I was super blessed today by being here this morning and then realizing that tonight that these folks that have made a profession of faith are going to be put into baptismal waters. That's the dream of every pastor, and that we can win some and baptize some. And so we're very thankful. There's a lot of excitement on both sides of the room up here tonight, and we're just thankful to God. So would you join me in prayer before we start? Our Father, which art in heaven, we thank you and we praise you. And when you were talking about humble this morning in our text, Lord, we feel so humble before you tonight. Humble and full of gratitude for the souls that you've seen. What a great witness and what a great testimony that we've heard already of what went on. Lord, you're just awesome. Help us to help these folks, as I heard someone say, to be disciples. Help us to, Lord, not let them fall into cracks of life and not be found just a few days down the road from here. But Lord, let us help them to find that grace in the sight of the Lord and walk in. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray.
Call your dad. And you call
make that profession. We don't know what God is going to use Trey for in our church or in our family, but we know that he's going to use him as he did the other folks that have been baptized. So you pray for all these. Pray, do you believe that Jesus Christ is God's Son and God has raised him from the dead? Have you asked Jesus Christ to come into your life to forgive you your sins? Then because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. So to the waters we have brought those who have made that profession. What does it mean?
Each other up, you know, and these new converts are going to need lots of prayer and they're going to need lots of support. You know, this next song is God Still Faithful. You know, when we think we've gone too far, we have never gone too far for God's hand to reach down. He promised he would be faithful to us. He has several promises in his word and we cling to those. Faith is so small, your back's against a wall. God above who's looking down in love. He's always been faithful and true. He is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. He knows your pain like no other. So don't be afraid. Step out in faith and call on His name. God's still faithful in the midst of it all. When it's just too much for you and you don't know what to do, God will carry you through. When hope is all gone and you've no strength to hold on, God's still
Lord. Y'all feel the Holy Spirit in here tonight? Amen. Huh? Amen. God is faithful, ain't He? Because I'm here to tell you, Everyone that was just dipped in that beautiful, glorious water has been on this prayer list.
Yes.
This prayer list, God is faithful.
Yes.
I don't know what song she's fixing to crank up, but hey, just praise the Lord. I'm telling you, God is good. I'm on cloud nine. Sinner saved by grace.
If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see a miracle of love that took me in its sweet embrace and made me what I am today. I'm just an old sinner saved by a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my place. With each breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven. Back with the living, I'm just a sinner. Of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven. I'm back with the living. I'm just a sinner
because of him. I'm telling you, if I go to scooting around here, just scoot around with me. You got to praise the Lord. Let it come out of you tonight, people. Do not quench the spirit. Don't quench that spirit. Go ahead, sis, let it roll. Somebody touch me, huh?
Many years he walked in darkness as he groped along the streets, with his hands stretched out for pennies or for just a bite to eat. It's the story of the blind man who met Jesus on his way, and with the master's touch, the man looked up as the scoffers heard him say, somebody touch me, somebody touch me. I was blind, but praise his name, I now can see. I was in darkness when Jesus found, but since he touched me, I now am free.
You feeling free tonight? We're free to worship.
One day he touched a crippled man, and he made him walk again. And the master saw with pleasure he had labored not in vain. Like the story of that crippled man, I once was bound by sin, but since the master came, oh praise his name, thank God I now can say,
sing it with me,
somebody touch me, somebody touch me. I was blind, but praise his name, I now can see. I was in darkness when Jesus found me, but since he touched me, I now am. I was in darkness when Jesus found me, but since he touched me, I now am free. Thank God I'm free.
Woo! Thank you, Lord. Feels good to be free, huh? Y'all, we wouldn't be free if it didn't come down. Hey, you hung on that cross, shed every drop of that precious blood. Listen to the words of this song. Put yourself in here. Put yourself in here. And I'm telling you, you'll find a place in that heart to worship tonight.
He came down to us. He gave his life for us. Almighty God, that's the miracle to me. He who despises sin gave his life for sinful men. The greatest love came from above when he came down.
Thank the Lord tonight for saving my soul. And I want to thank the Lord tonight for the opportunity to be here to see souls saved and to see those baptismal waters flowing. And it's not too late for anybody else tonight that needs Jesus Christ, because he came down. He came down for you and he came down for me. It's in the blood of Jesus. Precious blood for you and me. Yes, he came down to us. He gave his life for us. Oh, mighty God, that's a miracle.
He has blessed, and we are altogether thankful, but yet altogether unworthy.
Yeah.
And so we just praise the Lord for what he's going to do here yet. He's not through. And so we don't know what and how and where and when, but we know that he's God. Amen. And so y'all bear with me, this equipment, you know. We didn't used to have all this stuff, and we didn't have to worry about it. And I'm not really worried about it now, because we'll get it done. Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1, we're going to be, it's not going to be long, but it's going to be a word from the Lord. I'm very thankful this morning
Do y'all remember our lesson from this morning? What did you take home this morning that God sent you through our word this morning from Deuteronomy, where he was telling the people and the purpose that he had brought them out there for? Give me a couple of purposes, somebody real quick, that God had brought them into the wilderness for. Do what? Be his people and follow his commandments. Someone else? What? The fear of the Lord. What else? It was in that one verse there, number two. There was two or three things written there. What was it? Had to do with
that. Humble, humility.
Humble, came, brought you out here to humble you, and I brought you out here for what else? And that you might prove your heart. Prove your heart. In other words, well, how you going to do? How long you going to last? And that kind of thing. Anyway, Mark chapter 1. Let's join in and read together. We only got about an hour, and so let's take and make the best of it. Amen. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messengers before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee, the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. And we know that's John. John did baptize in the wilderness and preached a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel hair and with a girdle of a skin about his loins. And he did eat locust and wild honey and preach, saying, there cometh one mightier than I, after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and untie and unloose. I indeed have baptized you with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness, and he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beast, and the angels ministered unto him. And now after John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent you and believe the gospel. We, not long ago, not many messages ago, we preached on this Mark, and we preached on other portions of Scripture, but we did not preach on chapter verse 15 and believe the gospel. He went about to preach the gospel and believe. Some of the greatest preachers of the gospel does not believe what they preach. If you can imagine, Hitler, he memorized the gospel. I mean, any great orator could preach the gospel. Anybody who, individual, could align a word and a message and preach what men today call the gospel. But I want to tell you something unique happened in this scripture, and it happened in all the rest of the gospels. It happened to Jesus Christ, and it happened to John Baptist, and it happened to you. If God chooses to send you forth, first thing that's got to happen is you've got to have some Holy Ghost about you. You got to have some power about you when you go. You've got to receive that before you can understand the gospel. And that's why anybody can preach a gospel, but they can't preach the gospel without the Spirit of God. I'm telling you right now, I was just reading this week. I got out my old biblical recorder, and I wanted to see what they did at the state convention. And I was reading that, and I was looking at the advertisements, and their churches were advertising, well, we need this man with at least 5 years' experience, with a minimum of a doctorate degree from one of our major seminaries, and all this life experience. And by the way, we're a member of this, and we're a member of that. In other words, we don't believe all the Bible, but we want a man who does. Why in the world would you want somebody to believe all the Bible if you're not going to live all the Bible? Amen? If you're not going to live by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, why don't you just tear the pages out of the one you got and throw it in the wood somewhere? Because if it don't mean enough to you to do it all, it don't mean enough to do any of it. And that's exactly where we are, and that's exactly what we need to learn. If we'll learn and get a hold of these things, it'll change our lives. That's life-changing gospel, a gospel that's preached by the anointing of the power of God on the messenger that's bringing it. Amen? And so a few years ago, we had a man come to our ordination council to be ordained, and he hadn't even been baptized to preach the gospel. And said, nobody mentioned I needed to be baptized. Well, you see, that's the kind of churches we're getting people out of. Where was his pastor at when he got saved? Did the pastor not tell him about baptism? Did the pastor not lead him? Did the one that brought him not make sure that he understood that we need to be baptized?
Right.
I mean, come on, guys. That's the kind of world we live in, though. By the way, the advertisement says you don't even have to change. Come on over to this church. Come on over to this church. We don't want you to change. Come as you are. Leave as you are. Live as you are. And go straight to hell. Because really what we want you to do is puff up our numbers so we can break up the church downtown, steal all their members. We just want all the young people in Whiteville and Tabor City, we just want to have pizza every Sunday night. We just want to live worldly. And we don't care how we're going to have to do it. Because we don't want you to change. We want you to be a fool and listen to us just like you are. Amen. Y'all ought to have been up running at that right there. Because that's exactly what's happening. That's exactly what's going on in our society. I'm telling you right now, and we are not getting that message. We are not believing that gospel. And because that gospel is not empowered by the Spirit of God. And y'all have heard me over and again. You've heard me over and again talk about this book. Now, don't you go uptown or go to your office and argue with anybody about this book. If you're going to discuss a book in your office, ask the person you're going to discuss it with, are you a Christian? Are you full of the Holy Ghost? And if you're not, then you and I can't have a discussion together, because if you don't have the Holy Ghost living in you, all Scripture is given by inspiration. That means it's God-breathed. That means it's spiritual. And if you don't have the Spirit, how can you understand what we're about to talk about? And that's the deal. And so what it ends up in an argument. Now, I've told y'all down through the years time and again, in 1966, a large percentage of graduates of our Southern Baptist seminaries did not believe in the virgin birth. I'm going to tell you, if you don't believe in the virgin birth, you're eliminated as a Christian. If you don't believe, my friend, that Christ died on the cross for our sins, you're eliminated because you're not a Christian. And so I'm going to tell you, we have people that don't believe that. We have people that are in pulpits tonight, that are in major pulpits, that lead major denominations, who do not believe that it's a sin to be a same-sex marriage partner, who do not believe that it's a sin to abort a baby. They stand in our pulpits and believe that women have the right to do it. Well, they didn't read the book that was written under the breath of God, under the anointing of God. And if they had it, they wouldn't stand up there and say such a dumb thing. And that's the kind of thing, that's the kind of place where we've headed, where we're going, and where we're going to be. Believe the gospel. You know, that's the deal. We've got to believe it. We've got to have it. We've got to believe it. If we believe it, we'll live like it tells us to live. We'll look like it tells us to look. We'll walk like it tells us. I already made one man. Look at there, he's gone. But you can see these things, and you know what God's doing. Now I want to tell y'all something. When this gospel was first preached, and it was at Pentecost, that's where it was preached. And them old boys, what happened to them before they preached the gospel? Somebody tell me quick. I ain't got time to wait for you. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. They went into upper room, and the Bible said that they had a spirit of unity in the building up there. And as soon as the spirit of unity fell in the building, that revival broke out, and the Holy Ghost came and sat upon them as cloven tongues of fire, and they were all baptized with the Holy Ghost. And when they came down, people said, look at these people. Are they not drunk? They looked like they've been drinking wine already. They look like they're full. What they were changed, and that's what you'll be. And I'm telling you, four that got baptized tonight, when you got saved, not just when you got baptized, but somebody ought to knew that you were a Christian, because something changed when the Holy Ghost of God come in you.
Amen. And you ought to know it. When you believe the gospel, everything around you, the universe around you shakes. Now, listen to me. I understand. I understand that there are different methodologies. And methodology is nothing but the office stuff that you do in churches. I can understand that mega churches need mega operational offices that they operate out of. I can understand every bit of that. And I believe in that. I'll tell you right now, that temple in Jerusalem was awesome. There were thousands of people that went in and out of there. Don't have a thing against. But let me tell you what happened. Out of the temple in Jerusalem, a false gospel was preached. Can I tell you that church leadership killed Jesus out of that great temple? Do y'all understand that because you got a great temple don't make a great church? I'll tell you, here's the temple of God, the Holy Ghost of God. But it don't mean because it's big, it can't be great. I don't want us to get confused, because God can be in the great as well as in the small. And that's what makes it all good, is because God comes in and lives there. Amen. That's when we believe the gospel. We can only believe it when we have the Spirit. We can only understand it. And we can only know what we need to do, where we need to go, and who we need to go with, and how we need to get the thing done. We need to do it all under the anointing leadership of the Holy Spirit of God, that it would find a root of power and spring up among us into revival. Amen. I've said enough to have 3 revivals already. Amen. I done said enough to save every soul in this building that's lost, and every baby that's going to be born the next 100 years. If you'll just preach to them what I said tonight, you've preached enough gospel that they be saved. And so there's where we are, and that's what we need to do. We don't have time to linger or labor. We have to get on about the business of God. I'll tell you right now. I'll tell you, some old gal there may wear her eyelashes may be a little bit too long. Who gives a hoot? Some of them may have a little too bright lipstick on. Hey, who cares? But look here, if we are living godly, we'll take care of all that mess. Amen? We'll take care of it when that Holy Ghost is on us, because we know that he lives in us, and he'll tell you, all right now, you need to tone your stuff down. Hey, you need to come where you need to be. Remember, I will never leave you. I'm always with you. Amen. The eyes of the Lord are about the universe. You know what the eyes of the Lord see? Everything. You know what the ears of the Lord hears? Everything. I'm telling you, that's why nothing's hidden. That's where there's no place you can go that God's eyes or ears are not there looking. And so God, that's what he meant. Matthew meant in chapter 6, and when he said, when you pray, don't pray with a lot of words, because your Father knows what you need before you ask. Yeah. See, that's why, because his eyes have seen, his ears have heard, and God, and he gave us his Spirit that we could see. Having eyes we could see, and having ears we could hear. I could close my eyes and see the things of God because he's in me. He's alive in me. He's the light that shines in me. He is the light of my soul. He's the light of my path. He is the way for me to walk in it, that I can find glory to him. Amen. Woo-wee. Yes, but you see, that's it. And that's what God wants in us. I'll tell you, we've had a little touch of heaven here today and tonight, and I'm so thankful that I could be a little bit part of it in some way and in some capacity as we talk about the ways of the Lord. I'll tell you, I think, Brother Tony Ward, we're on the verge of something great. I don't think it's going to be a worldwide revival. I never have thought that. I don't think we'll ever see one again. But these people who are spending money and trying to promote a worldwide revival and get money from you, they are saying there's going to be one. There will never be a worldwide revival again, according to the King James Version of the Bible, which I read. And I don't care what language it was written in. It was written with the tongue of God, and God gave me his Spirit, and therefore I understand his tongue, and I know what it says. There will never be a worldwide revival. It's done. It's done. He offered one, but he offered one when he cried out, repent. He offered one when he said that he came and he offered himself to his own people. He offered a worldwide revival, not missing any house, any country, anywhere. He offered his son to the whole world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. There's no other way. We can call in Dr. Zeus, Dr. this, Dr. that. We can call in the greatest singers with the greatest records. We can call in the biggest churches. But if we don't call in Christ, we can never have a revival. If we don't give him preeminence, because he is God's only begotten son. He is God's heaven-sent son. And if we don't go into revival in him, we won't ever have a revival. And I got a sad picture in Revelation. It's a word picture, but I can put it in painting where Jesus is standing at the door of the church, our church and your church and the world church. He's standing there and nobody's home to say, come on in, Jesus. Nobody's there. And he left a little message for him. Behold, I stand at your door and knock. If you will open up the door, I'll come in. And nobody showed up. Huh? That's why we won't ever have a revival. Someone told me recently, they went to a church, and I don't even know what church it was. But they were telling me about the experience and said, the band was good. The band was good. The singing was good. What about the word? What about the word of God? What about that Holy Spirit begin to tingle and twingle? You see, have y'all ever felt the Holy Ghost? I want you to know you can feel him. I want you to know he'll make your skin feel like you've been to a massage and every fiber of your skin standing up on edge. You'll think you're getting ready to fly out of here when the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you. That's what happened in the upper room. Them little children jumped up and said, Mama, whoa, Mama, do you feel what I feel? Daddy, hey, can you feel what's in this upper room? Whoa, they came down them stairs and they felt something. They had come in contact with the Lord Jesus Christ. For the first time in their life, they had received the Holy Ghost of God and knew the truth. For he shall guide you into all truth. And you shall know the truth. And the truth shall make you free. And whom the Lord hath made free are free indeed. We've never had a more bound up church than we are bound up today. We today have so orchestrated the gospel that he can't be free. And come among us and extol the graces of God. Isn't that something? I'm so thankful. Believe the gospel. Believe the gospel. Lord, this should be your declaration tonight. You got it. Listen. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. I don't never want to have another thought that's dirty. I don't never want to say another word that's not salted. I don't ever want to do another deed that would be disappointing to you. Lord, I want my life to count. Before you go away tonight, you make sure you consider all that. I've met several people in my lifetime, in my ministry since 1972, like Trey, who had started off and thought they had Jesus, but came to one day and run up against life, and life said, no, you don't know Jesus. It reminds me of them sons of Sheba, whatever his name was. Them demons said, let me tell y'all something. I know them names you're talking about, but I'm going to tell you, I don't know you. And they tore their clothes off. They run naked down the street, embarrassed that they couldn't handle the demons and the devils. They wore the robe. They were priests. But they didn't know Jesus. You listening to me? By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, and that you love one another, and that you keep my commandments. Believe in the gospel. Believe and then declare, yea, Lord, I believe. So what is it tonight? I know that in Michelle's class, I wish they had a speaker up there. There's people in that room that needs to be saved. They didn't hear this message. But I know also that, like, there's people in that room that need to be saved. There's people in this auditorium that needs to make some decisions about your life in Christ. I'm going to tell y'all something, because Grandma loved you enough to drag you to church. That's a good thing now. I'm not throwing off. Because you've been drugged to church every day of your life don't make you saved. I'm telling you. Just hear, all you've ever heard is that some preacher preach. That don't make you saved. You got to have that upper room thing where something happens that's never happened before. And you're born again. Born again. If I use that phraseology like Jesus did, Donna, what does that mean? Right away, we know what birth is. And Nicodemus, being a scholarly man, thought like a scholar. And Nicodemus said, Lord, how can that happen? I'm probably 5'10" or whatever. And how can I go again to my mother's womb and re-enter there and be born again? See, that's the way the common man understands it, Addison. They don't really get a hold of what Jesus means there. But it's a work of God, not a work of man.
Yeah.
And what we've done, we relied on the work of man. And the work of man has failed us, because the arm of man is shortened, but the arm of God is not. And there's nothing impossible with God. And so we need to answer this question. Do we believe the gospel? And so, Lord, what do you need the Lord to do for you? There's no sin. I mean, that water is still warm. There's no sin in entering again at a real profession of faith. There's just no sin in getting it right. I'm just telling you right now, if you don't never enter the pool again, your heart's got to be right. And that comes only by rebirth, hearing the gospel and believing. Lord, I believe. I believe. Save me. But you know what we've done? I know people that pore over the scriptures, trying to make that say something that the people will believe. But that, see, that becomes a gospel of man when we pore over it and try to make it say something that might be more appealing. It's got to be the gospel that we've heard from Him from on high. It's got to be that gospel that it's like electric fence. When it touches you and you touch it, you change forever. You change. You won't ever be the same, because you waded out into the water, as Aunt Lizzie May said, until it was over your head. You've been filled, and you're full of the Spirit of God, and you won't ever be that same man, woman, boy, or girl again for as long as you live. So what is it we need to do? Miss Alice Holmes said, Preacher Tom, I have been here in this church all my married life. I have taught classes for 23 years. But 5 years ago, my best friend got killed in a car accident. And I knew that day, the Lord spoke to me that day and said, Alice, if that had been you, you would have gone to hell, because you're lost. She said, for the last 5 years, I've been teaching GAs in this church. She was a model church member, a model citizen, a model wife, a model mother. But she says, I'm lost. And if my God in heaven sent you here for no other reason, and I believe that was it, maybe one more, He sent you here to lead me to Jesus. Amen. And so that made all that other stuff that I've been putting up with, Tony, a little more bearable.
Yeah.
And even more so when I was in the bed one Saturday night, not long after that, and I got another phone call from a young lady. She was a Cameron. She said, Preacher Tom, and I said, yes, ma'am. She said, I am so sorry to bother you at this late hour tonight, but I got saved, and I just had to call and tell you. I said, girl, keep me up the rest of the night, because I probably will be up.
They were about the same age group in the same church. And here's what I can tell you. Probably 80% of the 300 people that attended when I was there were in the same boat. But they would not. They'd rather drink, Pastor Keys around, and sleep with somebody else's wife than to get their life straightened out. Telling y'all something, the Lord knows what you're doing. And if you ain't a Christian, you're just making footprints toward hell. You may go to your grave with a hidden sin, but you ain't hidden it from God. You'll take it with you, and it won't let you get in. Amen? Others of you may have other issues. It may not be soul salvation. Who knows what it is? The gospel demands service. The gospel demands more of us than you could ever imagine. In fact, folks, listen to this. I'm gonna announce something right now, and I want you to tell it all over everywhere you go this week. Next Sunday night, the men and women of this church are going to wash each other's feet. We're going to wash each other's feet right here in this church. Now, you old stuffed up Baptists, go ahead and poke them out there. But I'm going to tell you what, if I'm the only participant, I'll wash every one of his feet. It's not proper for me to wash the ladies' feet. But I will do it. I want to be your servant because the gospel demands me to be a servant. A servant of the children of God. If it means washing their feet, I will do it. And next Sunday night, if the Lord puts enough breath in this body to get the old boy here, Bug, I'm going to get your old stinking feet. Amen. Praise the Lord. And I just don't want you to talk because I ain't got time to talk too much. But that's the truth. We're going to do it. I'll try to explain to you where I get that. It's where Jesus washed his disciples' feet. Now, I'm not going to make a whole movement out of that. This is just something from our lesson this morning. He said that God said he humbled me. I feel humbled when you see four souls buried, as Paul wrote to the church at Rome, for we are buried with him by baptism into his death. And we are risen with him in newness of life. I'm going to tell you something, but it'll humble you, particularly if it's your son or your daughter or your neighbor or somebody you love, grandson. Listen to me. But listen to me. Obeying the gospel demands service. It places a demand on us, whether we volunteer or not. It places a demand on us because we understand that those before us serve us. So that we could be saved. They served the Lord with gladness and somebody made a way to my house and your house to tell us about Jesus. That guy Terry Cardera I was telling y'all about, boy, I've seen him beat the paths down to get to somebody's house and tell them about Jesus. That's why I'm so glad that his wife, Rita, straightened me out and told me not a secondhand message, but the gospel truth about him, because I'd seen so many people come to know Jesus because of God's anointing on his life. That's why I was so glad, and I cried holding the phone in my own home when she told me it wasn't Terry's fault, Tom. It was mine. Terry can't talk to me now. He has a condition that he can hardly walk. He can't talk. But she says he has a loving nature for the Lord, even in his sickness. She said, I believe he's always had it, and I believe he always will. The gospel is binding. It motivates us to service. Thank you for your service. In that service next Sunday night, we're going to recognize Christian servants. I'm not going into all the detail about that, but we'll recognize Christian servants. So I want y'all to put the word out, every member of this church that you see, encourage them to be here next Sunday night. Amen? Every member. I don't care if they got on the point with Grandma in Alaska.
call grandma and tell her what's happening. She'll say, cancel it, honey. I'd rather you be there. Will you do it? And finally, are you ready? Before you leave here tonight, I just want you to say, Lord, I didn't realize if this is your case. I didn't realize that obedience meant Christian service. I never put two together. And I know that I haven't been the Christian servant that I needed to be. And I have failed people. When we're not obedient to Christian service, we're failing people. And so we need to be obedient, okay? So if you have it, as I ask you to stand, or if you need to make a profession of faith because you're not a Christian and you know it and you've realized it, I want you to come too. But whatever God leads, you stand and you come. May the Lord help us. If you want to just give thanks, there's a place for you. Just come give thanks. If you need to talk about salvation, come and I'll talk to you. Just come on now. Let's don't hold back on the great author and finisher of our faith. Lord, the paths of sin, so long I have trod. Pay attention, young. Pay attention, invitation. Thing to tell you, they have cooked some hot dogs back there and stuff, and would like for you to join in. I don't know, just hot dog and chip or whatever they have, and I know it's not going to be a supper, but please just have a hot dog and fellowship, especially with the candidates for baptism and the people. But I just want to share this story with you, and I think maybe it'll help you. You know, for years living in the country, farmers, they would kill hogs and animals like that, and they would salt them down with salt, and then they had salt boxes and smoke. I just tore down a smokehouse at my rental house
that it, the walls were smoked, and that's where they put the meat in there. They smoked the meat. But they would do that. But as the years have progressed, the laws have just about banned doing this at home, because I don't know for what reason, maybe somebody got sick or whatever. But the story I want to tell you, it kind of fits in with our message tonight. And here it is. My father-in-law, which is Wilbur Burnhill, he's gone on now and his eternity. But he had killed some hogs. And Judy and I were staying in Norfolk, Virginia. And we didn't get to come home ever so often. But he said, youngest, when you come home now, I've killed some hogs and I have some hams, and I want y'all to have one of those hams. Now, his procedure of you know, you rub that salt and all that, that's the preservation, all that stuff on the meat, and put it in a salt box, and it soaks into it, and it that preserves the meat. And you remember that the Lord said, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith would it be salted? It is good for naught but to be cast under the foot of men. And they've actually built paths with salt that wasn't any good. They would cast that salt that wasn't usable, and men would walk on it. Y'all listen now, this is important. And so what my father-in-law did, he followed all the procedures of killing that hog, rubbing it down, putting all that preservation, all that salt and stuff, and put it in the salt box. So when we came home, spent our time at home, we went back and we put this thing in a, it looked so good. I here was one of my last that, man, I just can't wait till we get home and we cut it. And Judy can cut them slices off of there, and man, fresh ham in the morning, 4:30 before I go to work. Oh, tell me about it. My tongue's about to beat the top of my mouth out right now. Just thinking about it. We drove home with the noisy children riding in our car and me reaching back, slapping it with one every once in a while. But we got home, took that out, unloaded all of our stuff. I said, all right, Judy, it's time to pig out a little bit on that ham. We took it in there and I laid it in there. Of course, you want to wash that salt off and all that stuff. And I took a knife and I cut into it. We all had to run out of the house. It was so rotten. I'm telling you tonight, some of you, if you were cut open by Jesus, you'd smell so rotten. Because you've been able to fool people. You look like on the outside that everything is perfect. But when the Lord cuts you open, it's going to stink. And if I can be your friend and I can be your servant, you can call me in private and we'll talk, or we can get together in public. But I want you to get your heart right for Jesus. And I'm telling you, Sister Teresa, Kagan, Trey, Stace, we're going to go to heaven. Amen. And I want us to be together. Thank you, Stephanie and Sherry, for singing. Did y'all enjoy that? Wow. Thank you for playing. Thank you for being here. Thank you for everything. Buck, I tell you, isn't Buck great? He can step right in for you anytime. Amen. What a man of God. Thank you, Buck. Amen. And so, but just pray. I'm going to ask all you guys that got baptized, come on, get back up here.